Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of Inforum, a division of the Commonwealth Club by and for people in their 20s and 30s. I'm not quite sure why they let me in, but Inforum has a mission to inspire debate around political and cultural issues. I'm Alan Murray. I'm the deputy managing editor of the Wall Street Journal, and I'm here with Steve Levitt and Stephen Dubner, the authors of Freakonomics and its freakquel, SuperFreakonomics. Tonight's program is part of the Commonwealth Club's continuing in the know theme. Hopefully you'll leave here tonight in the know. If you want to know more about the Commonwealth Club or Inforum, you can join Inforum's active Facebook group. You can follow Inforum SF on Twitter, or you can visit the website at commonwealthclub.org/Inforum. Tonight's guests are also recipients of Inforum's 21st Century Visionary Award, given to select young men and women whose work further invigorates civic dialogue. Gentlemen, thank you both for being here.
Thanks very much for having us.
Thank you.
You have totally changed the way a lot of people think about economics and economists. I mean, you've heard all the jokes. An economist is someone who doesn't have the personality to be an accountant.
I hadn't heard that one.
Thank you. Good. How about?
Actually, I think Levitt actually does have the personality to be an accountant.
How about if you laid all the economists in the world end to end, they wouldn't reach a conclusion?
Yeah.
We can keep this going, but but you must feel pretty good about that. I mean, I think people think differently about economics. People at large feel differently about economics having read Freakonomics and the way you use the discipline.
Yeah, one thing I hear all the time is young people, you know, who are going to college. Now, we actually heard someone graduating from college. That's how long Freakonomics has been out, that people have actually been able to read Freakonomics, decide to be economists, and graduate from college. And I think be jobless.
Yeah. Well, they could have been journalists.
And I can't imagine how many people are now cursing us because what we do and what you learn in the 4 years of economics in college are two totally different things. And it's probably a very unkind bait and switch that we've offered to these young people who followed what we did. And, I mean, what do we do? I mean, you probably all know what we do, but what we do is we take the basic tools of economics, the idea that incentives matter, not just financial incentives, but also, you know, other kinds of incentives, caring about what other people think of you and whatnot. Put that together with a careful analysis of data and pay attention to correlation versus causality. Causality is what we care about. Correlation is what we easily observe in the world. And put that together with storytelling to try to, well, I guess in the other pieces, you're sort of stripping away the moralism. So most people, when you think about a topic like abortion, we think it through the lens of a moral and ethical perspective. There's nothing wrong with that. It makes a lot of sense to do it. But what we do is strip that away and say, well, if you just look at it from an economic perspective, you know, like an efficiency perspective, say, and what are you left with? And it's often leaves you with an uncomfortable feeling. And you know, that's true probably when you read about prostitutes. It's true when you think about environmental issues. And that, I think, is kind of our calling card. We're equal opportunity offenders, and we don't do it with malice. We do it with the goal of taking a purely economic perspective and seeing where that leads you.
And that's very different. I mean, we're going to get into a bunch of those issues you just talked about, but that's very different than the way people traditionally think about economics when they read the paper, macroeconomics, which, by the way, I think there's a pretty strong feeling in the current crisis somehow failed us.
Yeah.
Let us down.
Steve Levitt and others like him who do research, if you wanted to generally categorize it, you could call it microeconomics or often applied microeconomics. And yeah, I think the average person, I know when I first began writing about economics 10, 12 years ago, what got me into it was behavioral economics, very small scale, micro, small bore, mostly experiments that seemed to describe human behavior in a way that others often do try to describe, psychologists and anthropologists and so on, but economists use data in a different way to do that. Now, that was I was kind of like the college freshman that you're describing who kind of got seduced by one piece of economics that turned out to be just one little brick in a big building that was very, very, very different. And most people, like I did at the time, thought of economics as macro. And when you think, and I remember the, you know, all the things that we know are very, very important, but are A, very complex, and B, are not very good at looking forward often, you know. So I find it ironic and sad and also comforting somehow that now that we're just apparently getting out of this recession that was obviously very bad and remains very bad, that economists in the academy are still debating whether FDR's financial actions during the Great Depression helped get him out or exacerbated. And that can often be the case, that can often be the state of the economic debate within macro. So what we try to do are much, much, much lower hanging fruits. And as Levitt said, trying to describe the past based on a bunch of data is, we feel, much more kind of, you know, doable than trying to look at where a big, complex, dynamic system like the macroeconomy is going.
And if I could just throw in one thing on top of that, I mean, what makes macro so hard is that we have exactly one macroeconomy, and it's very complex. So what we almost always do in our studies is try to find, you know, what I might call natural experiments or accidental experiments, where, you know, you have mini states, and some states do one thing, some states do something different, and then you can actually, it's in a way trying to mirror the idea from science of a randomized experiment. And so if macroeconomics would be a completely different field of study if we had the power to create 100 different parallel worlds and shock some of them with bank failures, and other ones we do really big stimulus packages, and you know, the next one, Al Gore is president instead of George Bush, and you see what happens, right? So, I mean, it would be a completely different field, and we would learn. And the problem really for macroeconomics is we just learn too slowly because we are unable to generate variation and feedback to learn what works and what doesn't work. And so it ends up being, in some ways, a sort of a less scientific approach than microeconomics, where we can, you know, where there are millions or billions of people to study, and you get many observations, you learn much more quickly.
So you ask a bunch of very interesting, provocative questions in the book, and then you go about trying to answer them. And I want to go through some of those questions. But before I do, there's one question I have to ask you, because the two of you have now been at this for quite a while. As you said, there are people who started college and graduated college and are now out and practicing. Are you getting tired of each other?
I thought that was a question you were going to ask. No, it's interesting. We've the last few days we've been together. I mean, for the past couple weeks and the next week, we're kind of nonstop. And I was getting very. I'll be frank here. I was getting very sick of Levitt just earlier today. And then a pretty great thing happened. We were kind of exhausted and starving, and we sat down, we had a lunch, and we started talking about this project that we've been kind of batting back and forth without a whole lot of, just kind of a riddle that we're trying to figure out how to solve. And all of a sudden, that one lunch with the paper tablecloth, we started writing down the ideas, and then all of a sudden, the idea generation was so good and satisfying that I thought, yeah, I'm not sick of him at all anymore.
Right. So this is book three, Maximum Freakonomics, Cosmic Freakonomics.
If we do a third book, which we're not sure, it will be probably quite different. And I don't know, we probably shouldn't, I don't know, we should talk about it. You can talk about it a little bit.
It's so speculative. It would be wrong to even bring it up. But what I will say is that I probably like Dubner better today than I ever have. We started on a rough patch. If I could just take a minute to talk about how we got to know each other. So he came out to interview me for a New York Times Sunday Magazine piece. And this was back in, six, 7 years ago, I guess. And I had only reluctantly agreed to do the piece in the first place because my mother likes the New York Times Sunday Magazine, and I try to do things to make my mother happy. And so I consented. And so Dubner...
You read the Wall Street Journal, I'm sure.
My father reads the Wall Street Journal.
So, you got the family.
So so Dubner said he'd be in Chicago, and... would it be possible to come and talk to me? And I said, sure. I have an hour free in the morning right before lunch. And he said, well, I was kind of hoping for a little more time than an hour. And I said, okay, hour and a half, that'll work. And so he was very gracious. He's sort of passive aggressive sometimes. And so he just accepted the hour and a half. But then the hour and a half came to an end. It was time for him to go. And he said, well, if you're going to lunch, what if I just tag along to lunch? And so he came to lunch. And then after lunch, he said, well, you know, what are you doing the rest of the afternoon? And I said, I was going to go work in my office. He said, well, what if I just observe? And I said, that would be fine, except all I'm going to do is I'm going to sit and type at a computer, and I'm not going to say a word or talk to a person the entire afternoon. But, oh, that's okay. I'll just come along. Now, the thing is, he couldn't keep from asking me questions. So basically, he asked me questions, and then the end of the day came, and he said, well, you know, I'm in Chicago tomorrow. Could we do this start again at 9 a.m.? And the problem is, so he's, you know, writing a story about me for the New York Times Sunday Magazine, so I have to be nice to him, right? Because I could say, no, I'm tired of you, leave, okay? And imagine what the article would have looked like if I'd done that. So the second day passes, 12 more hours, and I'm thinking, okay, we're in the freeze. Oh, I'm going to stay one more day. I'll see you at 9 a.m. the next morning. And I was literally ready to kill myself by the end of the third day. And what was funny, he asked me all these questions, and not once did I bother to ask him anything about him. I mean, I didn't know anything about him except his name after 35 hours and 45 minutes together. And finally, in the last 15 minutes, I asked him what else he had done. And he told me these great stories about how he'd been the one person who got to interview the Unabomber in the federal
prison.
A lot
of similarities, the two of you.
And I realized, God, why didn't I ask more questions? It would have been so much more interesting if I had let him talk instead of talking for the whole time. And so then I think, you know, it was, you know, who knew what would happen after that? Certainly neither of us ever thought it would lead to this.
Yeah, so, you know, if you're not that smart, which I am not, then you have to spend a lot of time asking a lot of questions to try to figure it out. And one of the things that I felt about Levitt is, first of all, he is very smart. And one thing that was so appealing to me about his work and the way he practiced economics but could explain economics is that he could explain it. And so I was interested in economics as a writer, but I'm not an economist. And I find that generally as a writer, the smarter the people are that you're dealing with, the better they are at explaining it, even to some, and this is a, I don't know if, you know, there are many writers who listen to the show, I hope so, journalists, young people who want to be journalists. I think the single best thing to do is to not pretend you're so smart and not pretend you know a lot more than you do, because I learned this the hard way once. I got an assignment very early on in writing for an advertising trade paper, and I knew nothing about it. And I tried to do what everybody tries to do, which is say, you know, form a question that sounds kind of smart. And I think it was a very well-known ad guy in San Francisco, actually, I was on the phone with. And he said, he just stopped the conversation. He said, you don't know anything about what you're talking, do you? And I said, no, I don't. But listen, I really am interested if you want to take the time and treat me like a relatively bright eighth grader and explain it to me. And I find that when people are very accomplished and very bright, and they do want to talk about what they do, but they just need to be given the right avenue to explain it. So that's kind of what I found with Levitt. And it's, you know, it's worked out.
It's still working.
Yeah.
All right, let's go to some of the questions that you raise in the book. For instance, why is a prostitute like a department store Santa?
Well,
I'm not making this up, folks. I mean,
that's not a question you all ask regularly yourselves. So that's a question that we kind of answer in a fairly what I feel is really interesting. The first chapter of SuperFreakonomics, which is about. To boil it down a little bit, it's about women's wages. And the big story is about the fact that women have made great gains in societies, especially like ours, over the last 100, 200 years, and yet there's still a very prominent wage gap. And so we try to go a long way toward explaining the wage gap on different levels. Now, one industry that we look at school teachers, we look at finance, and we also look at prostitution, which is interesting because it's a labor market that's dominated by women. And it's a market for which there's often very, very, very little good data. So one thing that, you know, that we try to do is write about scenarios. In the first book, we wrote about crack-selling gangs, for which there's usually not an abundance of data. In this case, street prostitution, again, most of what we know are based on kind of surveys with former prostitutes or kind of imaginings of how these things work. And in this case, Levitt, along with a wonderful sociologist at Columbia University named Sudhir Venkatesh, basically undertook a very intensive field study where prostitutes were, you know, basically they hired, that did not come out at all right.
It gets worse.
I'm
off to do some research.
Now, can I just say, I'm from New York, so it's 11:30 at night for me, so I'm going to chalk that up to exhaustion. But so we undertook an anthropological field study. Does that make it any better? And what they did was hired trackers, which were women, mostly former prostitutes themselves, to basically follow around prostitutes the way I followed Levitt around for those 3 days in Chicago and write down everything that happened, including on a clipboard sheets that showed everything about every transaction that they had, every price, everything about the customer they could tell, the sex act that was performed, whether there was violence, a condom used, whether there was payment in drugs, whether there was a threat of arrest, and so on. From these big data, we were able to make some conclusions, which we write about in SuperFreakonomics, which I won't go into here a lot, other than to say that the wage was a very interesting thing to look at. That these women who have an incredibly horrible job, you just can't describe it any other way. Why do they do it? Well, it pays about four times what these women would make and do make often in legitimate sector jobs, which many of them often do that. They're prostitutes for 10 or 12, 15 hours a week, and then they work in the legitimate sector as well. The strangest wrinkle that we found in the data, however, occurred in one neighborhood in Washington, in Chicago called Washington Park, where during the summer, around the 4th of July in particular, there are a lot of family reunions and big parties and gatherings. And it turns out that a lot of the men who come to those family reunions, they're not satisfied by catching up with Aunt Ida and having the potato salad. They want some sex. And they go off in search of this prostitution for which there's already a pretty thriving market during the year. But in Washington Park, you see the market, the free market, as illicit as it is, really take off. And there's a huge spike in demand for prostitution during that period, 4th of July. And the prostitutes, who are entrepreneurs, they raise their prices. They work more hours. But most interestingly, women who during the year do not work at all as prostitutes come into this market to work these few weekends a year because there's a high wage, and they decide that that's what they're going to do for those couple holiday weekends. So how is a Chicago street prostitute like a department store Santa? The answer by now should be quite obvious, which is they respond to a holiday-induced demand shock by taking advantage of high-paying seasonal employment.
I'm
good.
I'm sure many of you were wondering about that particular question. Here's another one. This is my personal favorite. Why don't hospital doctors wash their hands?
Well, this is Dubner's too. You might get tired of him, but
you're going to get tired of me.
He's got the hospital thing, the washing hands thing.
Yeah, you're not allowed to do it.
I can
go on to another
question. It would be pearls to swine to let me answer a question like that. But no, let Dubner do it because it's excellent.
Well, no, it's not so excellent. We don't really answer the question why doctors don't do as good a job as they could. We describe the scenarios by which they don't, and it's a pretty serious failure. Now, this is not an anti-doctor rant, you know. I'd say many of our friends and people we write about all the time are doctors, and they're obviously doing all kinds of amazing work. But the fact is that 160 years after a fellow named Ignaz Semmelweis discovered that you really should wash your hands before you put them inside a person, it's often a failure that persists in hospitals for a lot of reasons. Doctors are busy. They often, you know, in a lot of rooms just aren't designed well. They, you know, the sinks are barricaded by equipment. And there are other people who say that there are psychological reasons that doctors feel that they're not the guys who are going to have or pass on the bad bacteria. But what you do find is that there is also what you might call a perception deficit between how doctors think they do and how they do, as best illustrated by an Australian study not long ago where a bunch of docs were asked during a period of observation to keep track of their hand hygiene rate and then report it back to these researchers. And at the end of this period, the doctor's self-reported hand hygiene rate was 73%, which is not 100%, not perfect, but you know, given all the constraints, you'd think not so bad. But here's the problem. During that same observation period, those same doctors were actually being watched by nurse spies who had been deputized by the hospital to watch what actually happened. The same docs who said they washed 73% of the time, in truth, washed 9% of the time. So you go from 3 out of 4 people who say they do something to 1 out of 10 who actually do. And that is kind of a key kind of idea that we write about regularly, which is the difference between what people say and what they do, what people believe and how they behave.
And I think one thing that's interesting is how one hospital, Cedars-Sinai, actually tried to solve this problem. They started with meetings and committees that were designed to solve the problem, memos that were sent around, it didn't work. They then went to fund.
You must wash your hands. Yeah.
They then went to financial incentives where they would actually offer Starbucks cards to the doctors when they were seen washing their hands, and that did not work very well. The doctors actually started gaming the system, and whenever they saw the trackers around, would run to the sinks and try to get the $10 Starbucks cards, despite the fact they were making $300,000 or $400,000 a year in salary. But the thing that finally worked is that they got out petri dishes. And they had one of the head doctors, they had the big doctors all put their hands in a petri dish at a meeting that was about hand washing, and then they let the stuff grow for a week, and they came back. And what they saw was so disgusting that they actually decided to put it up as a screensaver in the hospital, on every computer in the hospital. And that, more than anything else, turned out to be the magical weapon which operated through the right kind of psychological mechanisms to induce the doctors and the other caregivers to wash their hands. And that's now been adopted by many other hospitals. It's a funny thing is, so other hospitals email them and say, can we get a copy of your screensaver? You'd think it wouldn't be that hard to generate your own handful of bacteria, but I guess they think there's something magical about that particular hand that they found.
Okay, here's a good one. I don't know if this is a Levitt question or a Dubner question, but which is more dangerous, driving while drunk or walking while drunk?
So that's one we both can answer.
Yeah, we can both answer. What's your preference? Let's take a little vote here.
Okay, no, we'll go ahead. We'll go ahead. If you think driving while drunk is more dangerous than walking while drunk, raise your hand.
Wait, what was the question?
Driving,
if you think driving.
Driving is
so
more dangerous.
So for the radio audience, let's describe what's going on.
That looks like about half. Let's see how we go on the other one. If you think walking while drunk is... these people have read the book.
Yeah, you're very suggestible.
These are people who know that we wouldn't ask the question if that weren't the right answer. But so let me start by saying... Want me to take this?
Yeah.
Let me start by saying that I have done research on drunk driving. Drunk driving is extremely dangerous relative to driving sober. That my analysis suggests that drunk drivers are 13 times more likely to cause fatal crashes than sober drivers, which is very much in line with what other people have found. We've been told for 25 years, 30 years, longer about the dangers of drunk driving. There have been tremendous strides made in that dimension. Still, of course, a lot of people drive drunk. There are a million arrests a year for drunk driving, and it's estimated that about one out of every 140 miles driven is driven by a drunk driver. It's really an amazing statistic. But what no one has ever really bothered, I've never heard anyone think about drunk walking, okay? But when you look at the data, you get a different perspective. There are 1,000 pedestrians each year killed walking drunk.
Okay, out of 13,000.
Yeah, there are only 13,000 drunk drivers, people who are killed in drunk driving crashes. Okay, and 1,000 people are drunk walking. Now, the key thing is you got to get the denominator. You got to figure out, well, how many miles are driven drunk and how many miles are walked drunk. Okay, and we lay out some assumptions. It turns out there just aren't a lot of miles walked drunk in this country. It's a lot of work to walk drunk. People don't do it so much. If you start to then make some reasonable estimates, we come up with the number that per mile walked, drunk walking is 8 times as dangerous as drunk driving, okay, for the individual. Now, of course, it's hard to kill other people when you're walking drunk, so you have to factor that in. When you do that, it turns out in total deaths, there are 5 times as many deaths per mile walked drunk as there are driven drunk. So, look, and I want to make completely clear that we're not advocating drunk driving. We're not advocating drunk walking. But it's. But I think the
drunk sleeping is probably the safest.
Drunk taxi dialing.
Yeah, but I do. But I think what we start the book with that example, and I think what I love about that example is it's not something that anybody could have done it. It took about 5 minutes on the internet, trying to figure out what some of the statistics were, and yet. And once you think about it, it kind of makes sense, and you can even maybe remember back to some of your own more drunken walking episodes and think that maybe I could have been killed. And yet no one has ever talked about or thought about it. And I think that's kind of the power of ideas. I mean, not big ideas, not like string theory or theory of relativity, but little ideas and ways of thinking about the world differently that we're so much trying to cultivate with our approach to economics.
So friends, don't let friends walk drunk. That's the key. You know, the ways that people die walking drunk, once you actually look at the numbers and see what's happening, it's so easy to get, you know, if you're in a city, you just step off the curb into the path of a taxi. If you live, if you're somewhere suburbs, people like make the mad dash across the highway just with bad judgment, thinking they can make it. In rural areas, there are places where people literally, you know, they drink a lot at a friend's house or at a bar, and kind of walk home, then like literally lie down on the road to take a little nap. So it's like you see in North Carolina this one year, there's this epidemic of people lying down. And I think there was a movie too. Anybody know the movie I'm talking about where there was some drunk walking and sitting on the road kind of? I haven't either. Okay, pass on that. But
we'll move on. Okay, so here's another one. You have a two-year-old. You're putting him in the back seat of the car. Do you put him in a car seat or do you just buckle him in the seatbelt?
Well, you have to put him in the car seat because it's illegal not to. But what we write shows pretty clearly that the car seat, as much as we all have been encouraged to believe in its real safety power of its safety, that the car seat provides very, very little advantage to a child ages 2 and over as compared to an adult seatbelt, even though the adult seatbelts are not obviously optimized to fit.
How did this happen?
How did it come to so be that the government...
Again, wait, let me make one more disclaimer. I'm in disclaimer mode tonight. Either one relative to no restraint is an unbelievable improvement. In fact, of the single few things you can do in your entire life that will keep you alive, buckling your own seatbelt and those of your children are about
but
the most
who
important
decided thing. To tell all the parents they had to go out and buy these car seats if they don't do any good?
It began like a lot of... safety campaigns began with interested parties from different groups. So there were child safety advocates, there were some government officials, and there were parents who saw, you know, the automobile. I think the car child safety seat began, mid-70s or so, early 70s or so. And, you know, auto safety is a really interesting big topic. We write about it at some length. The seat belt was a phenomenally good, cheap, and simple solution. And one theme that we do... kind of bang on is that cheap and simple solutions often come along, invented by one or a small band of people who often are outside whatever industry they're kind of fixing, and solve these often complicated problems. So auto fatalities were so bad back in the early 50s that auto manufacturers were worried that people were just going to stop driving cars because there were about 40,000 fatalities every year, which is about the same number there are today. So just imagine how many fewer miles were driven back then. Robert S. McNamara, of all people, who is obviously most widely identified with being Secretary of Defense during the Vietnam War, was the man who said, you know, I think we could save a lot of lives. He worked at Ford if we put a seatbelt in these cars. And Ford didn't want to do it because they thought that by putting the seatbelt in the cars, it would broadcast to potential buyers that driving is dangerous, which it was. But as a marketing device, they thought it was a really bad idea. The seatbelt took many years to catch on. It finally did. But children didn't fit them. It was just the lap belt that was too big for them. And so parents and others got together to want to put in car seats. Now, what's interesting about it is the situation that we have that evolved was that the government mandates it, but it lets the automakers off the hook by not having to do anything about it, and it introduces a profit possibility for car seat manufacturers who make the things and that have to go in the car. Now, if you think about it, you have a seat belt, which is a solution that works for adults or works for anyone for whom it's properly sized. But the idea that the better solution for children would be to take the simple solution that works and then introduce a whole nother contraption that's made by one of dozens of manufacturers that has to fit one of dozens of different car seats and be buckled in with all these harnesses and straps, it turns out that 80% of all car seats are improperly installed. So when we looked at the data and saw that car seats don't do a better job of protecting children than even mis-sized seat belts, we wanted to look at data that compared the two, car seat crashes versus crash test versus seatbelt crash test for children. And it didn't exist. So we went to a lab to commission them to do these crash test dummy tests with a three-year-old dummy and a six-year-old dummy in a car seat and a booster seat versus in just the lap and shoulder belt. And it took us a long time to find a lab that would even do it because they get their business from car seat manufacturers. And when we finally got one to do it, the engineer on duty refused on the spot because he said, there's no way I'm going to let you put that dummy of mine, my crash test dummy, in a lap and shoulder belt because you're going to break them. And they're very expensive. So we had to sign a disclaimer that if we broke his dummy. Now, the irony was, this is a crash test dummy. But he was so sure that the car seats did such a better job than the seat belts that he was sure it would be destroyed. And we ran the test. The dummy wasn't destroyed, and the wires, the measurement devices in these dummies showed that, again, there was about equivalent performance between the ill-fitting lap and shoulder belt and the perfectly sized, perfectly installed car seat by this engineer. The conclusion, then, is no, you can't throw away your car seats. It would be illegal. We don't really have the better solution now, but if we wanted a better solution, it would seem to be, considering that half of all passengers in rear seats of cars are children. Wouldn't it be nice if the seatbelts that are there could fit them, right?
Yeah, if I could just chime in on two things. So I think the way we got to the situation where with car seats actually started very naturally. I think it tells a very typical story about government, which was that when I was little, I rode in the front seat in my mother's arms, right? That's what you did with babies. And initially, the car seats were a response to that. I mean, there's absolutely nothing you can do worse than hold a baby in your arms in the front seat for a crash. I mean, you would have been much better just putting the baby on the floor in the back seat. The baby would have been more or less fine. Probably, in fact, there's probably almost nothing better to do with a baby than lay it on the floor in the back seat of the car if it were happy to be there in terms of crashes. Because the way you get hurt in crashes is stuff, you know, collapses into you and hits you, and there's nothing... You know,
and the front seat is just... The
front seat's terrible, yeah. Adulter, I mean, as an aside, basically no one should sit in the passenger seat, right? The adult, the adult, you know, the one who's shocking, they should sit in the back seat too. I mean, that would... in fact, if you were trying to minimize the amount of deaths and you had to have two people in the front seat, you would actually put the child in the front seat because children do better in the front seat than adults do because they're smaller and they're less likely to get hit by things. But what happened is, so the car seat was a good response to mothers holding babies in their arms, but then this creep, where it went from being 2-year-olds to 3-year-olds to 4-year-olds to 8-year-olds, you know, and at the rate we're on, by the time we're retired, we're all going to be in car seats, right? I mean, it's sort of where it goes. Now, Dubner made a good point, which is that the reason we bring this over, why is this, you know, I think, again, it's interesting to think about how we, and I should also say not everyone agrees with our analysis. There's other data sets that don't give the same results, although our data are built on every crash that the government has recorded over the last 30 years. But, you know, so what might you want to happen in response to our research? Well, the department, believe it or not, the Secretary of Transportation, Ray LaHood, actually went onto his blog and commented on this part of our book. And what he said was, as someone charged with the safety of children in America, and as a grandfather, I don't have the luxury of crunching the data like these two guys do, but I am here to tell you car seats work. Okay? Don't listen to what they said, just believe us that car seats work. Okay? Which is an incredibly terrible response by government, right? Because what he should have said was, you know, I, as the person charged with keeping children safe and as a grandfather, I am disturbed by the fact that the data my own agency has been collecting for the last 30 years, when analyzed, suggests that the solution we've had for keeping kids safe doesn't work. So I charge the people below me to do the following things. Let's have my own researchers look at the data and figure out whether or not maybe these guys just made a terrible mistake and we would need to correct that. If not, well, there are these two different sets of researchers who get different results. Let's get them in the same room and let's force them to share their data and see whether we can get to the bottom of why they get such different results. And if it still seems like car seats don't work, we got to get a different solution, right? We can't stay and keep on doing something that's not working well at all. But you know, so I told him that on my blog. I told him that would have been a better response, and I'm waiting for him to post that particular response in his blog, but it hasn't happened
anytime.
Just yet.
All right, let's go back to prostitution. Which adds more economic value, a pimp or a realtor? Any realtors in the room?
I'm guessing there are.
Well, what about any pimps in the room? We're very glad to ask that question, too. Not be discriminatory.
Oh, you want me to?
Sure.
Are there realtors? I'm guessing there are. I mean, if there are 400 people, there have to be a few realtors. There's a million.
No one's there.
Yeah,
one.
Okay.
There
so, I, what's that? Sorry?
What? You're not a pimp or a prostitute. You're a realtor.
You're just scratching.
Well, thank you for admitting that.
So we might be seen to somehow be anti-realtor, and we're not. We're not anti-people. The point is that realtors are people, and people respond to incentives, and that's the way it is. And the argument we made in our first book was that the commission structure as set up for realtors doesn't work in the best interest of their clients often. So we did something in the new book that's really just a small piece, but we did, you know, I mentioned the street prostitution study earlier, and one very interesting feature of that was that it involved prostitute populations from different neighborhoods. And, you know, Levitt mentioned earlier when you're looking for kind of accidental experiments or differences in differences where you can measure what happens in one place and what happens in another place where they're very similar in some ways, but one significant difference. In this case, there were two populations of prostitutes in very similar neighborhoods, very similar clientele, and in one place they had pimps, and in the other they didn't. So we set out to measure what you might call the impact of the pimp, or pimpact. And what you want to know is this. Now, first of all, we should say that a lot of the common knowledge about what a pimp does and what a pimp is from movies and so on turned out not to be in evidence from this study. The pimps were, you know, I won't say the pimps were the good guys at all, but the pimps were kind of more conservative figures in this neighborhood who, if you were a prostitute working for them, you experienced higher wages, less violence, fewer arrests, and so on. So what we did is we tried to look at, you know, the pimp charge is 25%. It's a big cut. What kind of value do they provide? Well, it turns out that prostitutes with pimps made a lot more money and worked a lot fewer hours than the prostitutes without pimps, in part because the pimps were essentially marketers who, this was in Chicago, as we mentioned, they would go to the riverboat casinos in Indiana and go downtown in Chicago and basically drum up business and bring back higher paying clients for the prostitutes, which if you think about it, if you're selling a house, it's not so dissimilar from the services you're hoping for your realtor to do is market and present your property in the best light. So then we looked at a study. Now, this is not apples and apples. This is apples and oranges, to be sure. We looked at a study where homes were sold in one market in Madison, Wisconsin, by realtors, and homes that were sold in Madison, Wisconsin, by owners, a very active FSBO, or for sale by owner site. And it turned out that the advantage conferred to the homeowners who used a realtor was smaller than the advantage conferred to prostitutes who used a pimp, which is another way of saying that the value provided by a pimp in a transaction, if you're the prostitute, is greater than the value provided by the realtor if you're selling your house.
But was the value provided by the realtor equal to the commission?
It was actually about a wash. You actually paid for, you sold the house for the amount you sold the house for, basically you lost the commission. So if you wanted to sell the house on your own, you could pocket the agent's commission, but you'd have to do the work for yourself too. So there's a big difference. I mean, if you want to pay 5%, you can do that. If you don't want to pay the 5%, you can sell the house on your own, and there are flat fee agencies, and there's all kinds of different pricing structures that are coming into that market now.
Okay, let's get to global warming, global cooling. This has been the main source of controversy since the book came out. You've been accused of giving comfort to the global warming deniers, people like the editorial page of the Wall Street Journal, that sort of thing. If you could do it over again, would you do it differently?
I don't think so. I mean, we actually wrote on our blog today that, you know,
I think before we answer that question, we should just say what we did. Don't you think we should say a little bit what we did for people who don't know?
Okay.
Briefly, very briefly. So what we really set out to do in this chapter, as in other chapters, is to take an economic look at something which is usually not looked at in a very economic way, and to strip away any ideas about like kind of what's right or wrong, what we, you know, feelings of due, what we owe to the next generation, etc., and really answer a simpler, kind of more of an engineering question, which is we know that the Earth has gotten hotter. We expect it will get hotter still, okay? And the usual solution which is offered for cooling the Earth is to produce less carbon, okay? And we say that we don't think that is a very good solution to the particular problem of lowering the temperature of the Earth for three reasons. The first reason is that even if we were to cut carbon emissions dramatically now, because carbon dioxide stays in the air a half-life of something like 100 years, it'll be many, many decades before we feel the effects of the cooling. So in essence, the planet will continue to warm for another 40, 50 years. It just doesn't seem like, you know, if you had another option, you wouldn't want to wait that long. The second is that how in the world we're actually going to get the kind of consensus and the behavior change that will lead to dramatic reduction in carbon is a very, very thorny question, and one that economists think about a lot and think that this kind of collective action is very, very difficult. The third one is the cost, that the people who try to estimate the costs of this kind of carbon mitigation come up with numbers like it will cost $1 trillion per year, essentially, to the end of time to do this kind of mitigation. And $1 trillion, it doesn't seem like that much anymore, but when you really start thinking about it, it is a lot of money, okay? So we try to say the question, well, what if we really were in a jam, okay? And we wanted to really cool the Earth in a hurry, okay? We didn't want to wait 40, 50 years. Is there another option? Okay? And we explore scientific solutions that come under the rubric of geoengineering, where the science is pretty well understood. There are really three we talk about. The two, there's one that's incredibly repugnant to people. Okay, and that one is based on actually mimicking nature and what happens when big volcanoes erupt. And so when Mount Pinatubo blew in 1991, it sent enormous plumes of sulfuric ash into the atmosphere. Some of that went all the way up into the stratosphere, and it turns out that when you put sulfur dioxide in the stratosphere, it forms a sort of haze which can reflect 1 to 2% of the sunlight. It's like a sunscreen kind of, and that cooled the Earth. So all of the heating of the Earth that had happened over the previous roughly 100 years was reversed for a year or two after Mount Pinatubo until that sulfur dioxide eventually fell out of the atmosphere. Okay, so these scientists that we talk about, and I think it's well understood scientifically. It's not even really very contentious that this would have the effect of cooling the Earth. That may have, you know, the other complaints you might have about it might be legion, but it would probably work to cool the Earth. But these guys have built, their solution is essentially to build a 100,000-foot-long garden hose, to which they hoist up by helium balloons, all you really need is to turn the handle, and you don't need very much sulfur dioxide, so what can come out of two garden hoses, one at the North Pole, one at the South Pole, is enough to cool the Earth essentially to whatever temperature that you would like it to be according to the models. Okay, so that's the repugnant one.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, and I think many people think that that's like crazy. We're going to pollute some more to take care of the problem we've had from polluting. The other one, which is sounds and feels a lot nicer, is a cloud whitening scheme. So the dark things absorb a lot of heat. The oceans are very, very dark. There are not very many clouds over the oceans because there are not the nuclei that seed the clouds, which is usually from dust. There's not much dust over the oceans. Salt can also seed clouds, and so what you need to do is just figure out how to spray some salt water up into the air, and that can serve to make the clouds. And the belief is from the models that if you could just have 10,000 little solar-powered dinghies that just puttered around in the oceans and flipped up some salt water into the air, that would generate enough cloud cover over the oceans that it would reflect enough of the sunlight that through that channel you could also lower the temperature of the Earth, offset any effects of warming going forward. And that's sort of what the chapter is.
Now we're going to go to questions from the audience in just a minute. And you can see there are two microphones here. If you have a question, you might want to get up now and line up at the microphone. I know some of you are kind of far away. But Stephen, a lot of people say that by even raising those issues, you have suggested there's a low-cost way to deal with this problem and drained what political will there is for addressing carbon emissions.
That would be a bit like, it's actually an analogy we write in the book, it's a bit like blaming the heart surgeon for rescuing the guy who behaved badly. Would you like it to have not gotten to that point where he needed heart surgery? Yes. Were there risk factors that were of his own making and some that were entirely self-induced? Yes. Would a geoengineering solution create what you'd call an excuse to pollute, which again we address in the book? Quite possibly, yes. That's not a reason to not entertain it as a solution if warming is the problem that you're trying to address. So, you know, the thing is we, I think why some people, especially who hadn't read the book and were kind of predisposed to be very distraught about these kind of solutions, what they felt when they did read the book is that, well, we did actually address a lot of the reservations about potential unintended consequences, about the excuse to pollute and so on, but instead of making it an argument that's very familiar, which is that we've polluted way too much and we need to drastically stop now and it's our only chance, we discussed that mode of thought, but instead of having that be kind of the 80% or the 90% of the argument as it typically is, and then the 10% where you kind of throw up your hand and say, gosh, what the heck do you do? Instead, we kind of use the 10% or 20% to say, this is the argument that we now know, that we've polluted way too much and that the current plan on the table is carbon mitigation, and really that's the only thing that can work. And instead we spend 70 or 80% looking at the problem differently and proposing some different solutions. So to me, the happiest news about this is that tomorrow, this had nothing to do with our book, but tomorrow on Capitol Hill are the first ever congressional hearings on geoengineering. So, you know, our argument is essentially that if the problem gets bad enough to worry about that cooling needs to happen, then it would be great for these guys who've been thinking about this, scientists, engineers of different types, to have a seat at the table. And I think that they're getting a seat at the table, and we can really have that debate.
You do have, one of the people you quote in the book is Ken Caldera, who has subsequently said his views were misrepresented, and one quote in particular, that carbon is not the right villain, was a misquote.
Yeah, this is a rabbit hole to go down. So if anybody really wants to go down the rabbit hole, they can start at our blog, which is the Freakonomics blog at the New York Times, or actually just today I posted what might be kind of the final word from Ken Caldera and whether he was misrepresented or not. And the short answer I would give is essentially no. And what we wrote about Ken, just so you know, we worked in concert with Ken Caldera, who's a climate scientist at Stanford, and others who are part of this group called Intellectual Ventures. And we did something that we felt was the only thing to do and the responsible thing to do, which was after we had a draft of the chapter, run it past them all. There's a lot of science in it, a lot of opinion in it, and so on. And Ken Caldera read the chapter, made many comments on the chapter. His comments were incorporated. We ran it past him again, another draft. And there was a line that Ken admits that he really doesn't like and should have taken stronger action on it and or should have read more carefully and didn't. And we've decided we're going to amend that line in the book in future printings, and it's honestly, it's not a very drastic amendment to what exists now. So we talked a lot about Ken's different work in carbon mitigation and identification of problems like ocean acidification and so on. But if you're looking for a black or white judgment on whether anyone's scientific research was represented in Freakonomics, Super Freakonomics, or to get back to your original question, would we change it? Right. The answer is essentially no. Yeah.
So I know we want to take questions, but so can you just, so we asked Ken Caldera, what, if anything, do you want us to change about this chapter? Okay, the entire chapter. Okay, and I think
Dubner, what about the quote, carbon dioxide is not the right villain?
Okay, so, right. So, what is, so he wrote back to us, here's a change I would make in your chapter. So, can you say the sentence before
the sentence?
The sentence
that exists now is something to the effect of, it's in the middle of a section where we're talking about Caldera's different research on carbon, the dangers of it, the upsides of it, and so on. And the line is something to the effect of, yet Caldera's research tells him that carbon dioxide is not the research in this fight. So it wasn't
it's
a quote.
It's not the villain.
Excuse me. What
not
did I say?
The research.
Not oh,
the
excuse
villain.
Me. Not the right villain in this fight. And it wasn't a quote from Caldera, so it wasn't a misquote. It was our assessment of what his research told him about mitigation. And again, he's part of this company that's trying to look at geoengineering solutions. So his proposed change to that would be to say, and again, I'm paraphrasing here, but something to the effect of, yet carbon dioxide may not be the right villain in this fight. Right. So it's a pretty slight distinction, and that we not attribute that thought to his brain. That the argument still comes within the that the thought still comes within the argument of what we write about Ken Caldera's research on carbon and carbon mitigation, but that we not attribute that overarching villainous statement to his particular brain. So really, of all the dozens of other things that we wrote about Ken and his other research, which is, you know, very important to this debate, that was the single change. So I would like to think that represents him and us well in arguing that there was no broad-scale misrepresentation of any kind.
Okay, let's open it up to questions. Please come to the microphone if you have a question. In the meantime, I'd like to remind the listening audience that you're listening to the Commonwealth Club's Inforum program, and tonight we're talking with Steve Levitt and Stephen Dubner, bloggers and authors of Freakonomics and SuperFreakonomics and the yet-to-come Cosmic Freakonomics. And I'm Alan Murray with the Wall Street Journal, and you have a question.
Good evening. What makes you choose a topic? Because it seems that the crucial part of the work is on the data. And you just said that you've actually commissioned some studies, but also found that you have, in part, gotten data from other sources in the past. So how do you choose those topics? And is the data the crucial point?
Yeah, I mean, that's it's a hard question. We're not really very systematic in that. I mean, in my entire academic career, I've just kind of wandered around and looked at stuff, and when something catches my attention, I study it. I mean, it's one of the beautiful things about having a job, say being tenured at a university, a research university, is you have almost no obligations to do anything for anybody. So you have the luxury of being completely self-indulgent in how you do things. So I've always made is something interesting to me the primary thing that determines it. Now, I would say 95 out of 100 things that I find interesting and I try to study, I fail miserably. I either can't get the data or it turns out that my intuitions were completely backwards. I can't get the data to tell me anything consistently. But I don't in any sense, I think, have like a research agenda. Most academics have a research agenda. They care passionately about something. They, they build on it over the whole career. But I my own thing is I'm sort of a dilettante in a way that I like to take on different questions, and when I stop having good ideas in some area, I move on to the next area. So thank you.
Go ahead.
Well, one of the things I so enjoy about your work is that you take very touchy subjects and marry it with very quantifiable data, which, being someone from the Bible Belt, is great for me when I have to discuss difficult topics with my family or friends from there. But I'm just curious, on more of a personal level, what have you found? We're always talking about the quantifiable level, but for you, what have you found, and how's your work changed you from the aspect of just, what are your perspectives on the human condition?
So thanks for the easy question. I'll give a very brief. I actually love that. I actually think about that question probably more than Levitt does, because I'm not an economist, because they don't care about the human condition so much. I'm sure Levitt has a much more worthwhile answer than I do. But one big challenge that I find a lot of different people trying to address from many different angles, and economists are doing this now, and psychologists do it, and philosophers do it, is really trying to figure out human happiness. And to me, at the end of the day, that's all I care about. And my feeling about that is driven by the fact that I have two kids, they're 9 and 7, and if they're doing well and thriving and doing well in school and having friends, I could care less how I'm feeling. My happiness is really derived from them. And that's a realization I've only gained in the last few years. And if things are going great for me and they're miserable, it doesn't matter how great they are. So I am very interested in trying to figure out, somewhat more systematically, how and why people are happy. And there's been some fascinating research on this subject in just the last couple years. A fellow who writes on our blog, Justin Wolfer, is a really interesting economist, is writing about women and happiness and this very strange paradox, which seems to be that as women in the last 20, 30 years have earned more, gotten more power in the workplace and other arenas, that their happiness seems to be declining. So to me, all these questions we're asking about the particulars of social policy and car seats and prostitution, or even things like climate change and global warming, to me, if we can figure a way to address a topic like happiness in a way that's really compelling and convincing and worthwhile, I think that would be a great contribution.
Is that the third book?
That would be a good third book.
As a follow-up question, then having children, does the work that you have put together in your first two books, I mean, what are the implications for the future there?
The implications for children in the first two books? I'll tell you one thing. This is not scientific, but one thing I observe, I think our most enthusiastic readership are boys from the ages of like 13 to 18. And the reason I think, and I don't know why it's boys and not girls, but that's who we hear from a lot. And what I think is interesting about that is, I remember when you're that age, it's this very odd dissonance that you're going through in life where a lot of what you learned and were told as a young person, you're finding out is not quite true. That your parents protect you for good reason often, and that you find out that when you're getting to be that age that, you know, politicians actually say one thing in public and then they do something else when the doors are closed. And at that age, it's a very dissonant reckoning that life isn't as has been explained to you. And therefore, I think why those people in that cohort read books like this and like them is because we say, you know what, you're right. It's not what it appears to be on the surface, but it's not so hard to figure out what's going on. You just try to ask some probing questions, try to look at problems from a very different angle than other people typically look at them. And most importantly, and you know, this is where Levitt's research is really central to this, is find data. Don't make your decision. Everybody wants to fix or change the world in some way. And we're all in a hurry to rush off to do it, but we often make our decisions and spend our resources based on our emotion or anecdote or opinion as opposed to data. And I think that there's a lot of value in that.
Thank you.
Love the books, love the blog. Thank you. My question is, online communities and economies, have you spent any time looking at not just eBay, but Second Life and World of Warcraft, these large online economies that have to deal with fiscal and monetary policy?
Yeah, so I have, so economists are becoming interested in these alternative economies, doing experiments in them. So in Second Life, economists have set up shops where they run the same kind of experiments that they do on college students in the lab. They run them in these online communities. And what I have wanted to do, it's actually interesting you bring that up, because I said at the beginning about how macroeconomics, if we could just have 100 different worlds that were all the same, and then shock them in different ways. And so I've talked on a number of occasions with people who run these, what do you call, massive multi, whatever they're called, things. It's kind of a different world that I'm not part of them myself. But I've tried to convince them to let me, induce bank failures or the equivalent in their economies. And they're interested, except they make so darn much money doing it that they're not actually, we've never managed to get them to pull the trigger. It would be fascinating to see. I mean, because things with inflation. So there's some things with inflation that people have done, the gold diggers are one of the most interesting phenomena in these worlds. So in some of these games, there are actually enormous numbers of Chinese workers who sit at computers and hit over and over, because there are markets where you take the currency in these games and can, say, resell them on eBay. And what's most interesting is in how other companies of Chinese workers who are gold digging will then send groups of warriors to go kill all of the in the game, not in real life, but in the game, to kill the characters of the Chinese gold diggers, so that they don't drive down the price of the. It's incredibly fascinating economics.
Question.
I would like to ask your opinion on what I would characterize as a libertarian economic philosophy. And is there a balance between an individual's economic choices that he makes in his life as to balance against social responsibility to the group as a whole? And I'd like your opinion on that.
Yeah, that's
a great question.
That is a great question.
Yeah.
That's hard ones to Dubner.
That's to me? No.
All
that's
right,
a...
Well, I, Well, I'm from Chicago. You want me to answer?
I'd love you to answer okay, that,
so,
yeah.
Well, so look.
It's way too hard for me.
I'm from the University of Chicago Department of Economics, and if there's any place in the world that that kind of has subscribed to the sort of libertarian idea over the last 40 or 50 years through Milton Friedman and Hayek and people like that, that it's... it certainly is there, and that sort of strain is there, and you know, and I initially, when I came to Chicago, I really didn't believe very much in markets and things like that, and I was just said I'd come to Chicago for 1 or 2 years to be a faculty member to kind of learn about the enemy, and then I'd go back to my, you know, Cambridge world that I lived in that had a very different view of the world, and I really became convinced in talking to the economists here that the sort of that their view was a powerful one for understanding the world. I think the ideas are far too deep, though, to be honest, for me to be the right messenger to try and talk about them. I mean, I learned very early on in my career that I was a little thinker, that I was good at taking piles of data and understanding pictures, and I was very bad at the sort of philosophical, and political arguments that about. And I think it really, because I think really the idea of libertarian versus the role of government, I mean, those are big and powerful ideas that are not really grounded so much in science or in economics, but really in moral philosophy. And I think I'm just very ill-equipped to be someone to tell anybody else what they should or shouldn't believe politically or morally.
It is worth noting, though, that the school of what's now called libertarian paternalism has come in part out of Chicago, particularly the work of Richard Thaler, which is basically kind of encourage. It's an oxymoron, but it's the idea that we can encourage people to make better choices for themselves and for society by nudging them or tricking them into the right mode of thinking, which I think that's exactly the way that we need to be thinking about it.
Go ahead.
Thank you for being here, and I'd like to say hi to the elephant in the room. With your proposed solution about the hose in the balloon, we've still not recovered from the past balloon fiasco, but what is the good? Speak to the governance of that. Who governs that? Who monitors the effect, the amount, where we position it? A little bit about that and amount of that and stuff.
Yeah,
You know, we address this in the book. This is one of the biggest problems. If you come up with, pretend for a minute that we're the garden hose to the sky idea, or the strata shield, as it's sometimes called, could be real. And probably the way we think of it most likely is that it's a sprinkler system in a house. You build a house, you do everything you can not to burn the house down, not to have a fire in the house, but you want to have something there in case it gets to that point. Well, in a house, it's easy. You own the sprinkler system. What about the garden hose? Who owns it? So these are topics that, if it came to be, would be incredibly difficult geopolitical project. You know, we write that if Al Gore somehow converted and became an advocate of geoengineering, which he's very much not, and decided that carbon mitigation, while it achieves a lot on a lot of levels, would not be sufficient to cool the Earth, and wanted to put up the garden hoses himself, he might win a second Nobel Prize and maybe a second Oscar as well if they filmed it. If Hugo Chavez, however, decided that he liked the same idea and he put it up, he would probably be visited by the U.S. Air Force and shot down in about 5 minutes. So the governance of this is almost, you know, it would obviously be one of the most difficult issues to look at. But I think that the way to think about it is this. Did anybody notice that Beijing made it snow the other day? They seeded clouds, they wanted some more moisture. I think they wanted rain, and they dialed it down a little bit too much, and they got snow. So the idea that no one has been trying, will be trying, is trying now to do things like this, I think is almost in a weird way one of the most compelling arguments to get it on the table before people who can band together and take some responsible stewardship for it.
I'm sorry, this is going to have to be the last question, and we'll need you to keep it short.
I was actually going to ask a two-part question.
No two-part questions. Forbidden. You want to pass to the next guy?
I'll ask the second question then. I wanted to know your thoughts on the Outliers book and from an economic perspective, given that the book is really about, you know, chance and, you know, how you're born and so forth and things being out of your control and how much validity, in your opinion, you think there would be. Thank you.
No, you go ahead.
Oh, so I love Malcolm Gladwell. We both, you know, we feel that he kind of made our books possible in a way by showing that you could write a book that had, you know, 100 different stories in it and no beginning, middle, and end, really. Now, his actually have more of a beginning, middle, and end than ours, because what Malcolm does is takes one interesting idea and then assembles, you know, all these different stories about it that illustrate different facets of it. We have no central idea at all. We just have all these stories and kind of glue them together. But Malcolm kind of tricked people into thinking that they could read our books like they read his and that they could be satisfied. And so far, the trick is working on our favor. Now, in terms of outliers, you know, he makes a really interesting argument that's very similar to what we've argued in a small way in the past, which shows that little things that you wouldn't think would matter, like a birth date for an athlete, can really have a big effect. Youth sports, you're born earlier in the year, you're a little bit bigger, you as an athlete, you get chosen more by the coach, you get played more feedback, and so on. And that effect can last all the way up into the professional ranks. You look at world-class soccer, hockey, and in baseball, you see this effect. In the States, it's different. It's not a January 1 birth date. It's more in the summer, because Little League is usually organized, I guess, around the school year, an August birthday. And we address this, but what's really interesting is this. We can get really tricked by these small effects, like the birth date bulge. It's a really cool story, and we love it as much as Malcolm does. But if you measure the advantage you gain from being born, let's say, in the right month, versus an advantage that you gain by a very different kind of birth date circumstance, you'll find that that second birth date circumstance is hundreds of times more powerful. In other words, if you want your child to become a Major League Baseball player, and you do everything you can to make sure that child comes out, first of all, that it's a boy, and that it pops out on August 1st exactly, that you've done everything you can, except the one thing you should have done is you should have been a Major League Baseball player yourself. Right? So, and this is something that is fun to write about, because we love to look around the margins and fiddle at the edges, and we sometimes forget that the most important determinant of something really important is a really important determinant. And so, you know, you just look at, I know you all don't care, but I do. The Yankees hopefully by now will have won the World Series. Okay. What do you hate? Is this just general Yankee hatred, or you're pro-Philly? What is that? All right. But anyway, Jerry Hairston Jr., right? He's not there because he was born in August. He's there because his dad played baseball. And there are some advantages that we really shouldn't forget. So, you know, we like to argue that talent is fungible to some degree, but there's also a lot to be said for good genes.
So this program does have an end. The end is now. But let's give a big hand to Stephen Dubner and Steve Levitt.
Thank you.
I have one last thing to say, and that is that this meeting of the Commonwealth Club's Info Forum is closed.